There's so much in store for the CIUT 89.5 FM Fall Membership Drive, November 13th and 19th. Diana Krall and Bruce Coburn tickets, a trip to Iceland, and many more fun prizes. Plus, membership includes special discounts throughout the GTA. Donate now at www.ciut.fm.
CIUT 89.5 FM, the sound of your city. Celebrating 30 years on the FM dial. Stream CIUT or listen to recent shows at www.ciut.fm.
Hey, good evening and welcome to HOWL. This is your host for the hour on this November 7th, 2017. I hope you can stick around for the hour. We will be speaking with Kate Cayley on the phone about her book of poetry called Other Houses. And in the second half, we'll be speaking with Aaron Tucker, who has this fascinating book. And I look forward to talking to him. It's called Irresponsible Mediums, The Chess Games of Marcel Duchamp. And that's with Aaron Tucker in the second half. We're going to start off with a track from Brian Adams. This is Heaven on CIUT 89.5 FM. Brian Adams with Heaven, and I believe that we have Kate Cayley on the phone. Hi, Kate.
Hi.
How are you?
I'm very well. How are you?
Good, thank you. I'll just introduce you to our audience. Kate Cayley is the author of a previous poetry collection, When This World Comes to an End, also by Brick Books, which is her book we'll be talking about tonight, Other Houses, is published by Brick Books. She's written a young adult novel, The Hangman in the Mirror, with Anik Press, and a short story collection, How You Were Born, Peddler Press, which won the 2015 Trillium Book Award and was a finalist for the Governor General's Award. She is a playwright in residence with Tarragon Theatre and has written two plays for Tarragon, and she lives in Toronto with her family. So thanks very much for being with us tonight. And
thanks for having me.
Oh, you're welcome. So Other Houses, has this been launched?
It's actually going to be launched on Thursday. Here's a little plug. It's going to be launched on Thursday at Ben McNally Books.
Oh, that's a great bookstore.
Isn't it wonderful?
Yes,
it
is.
It's a beautiful bookstore.
Yeah, it really is a beautiful bookstore. I've been to readings there before, and it's quite a nice setup. So this is good timing.
Lovely.
We can talk about your book.
Good timing.
And encourage everybody to go to the reading on Thursday.
Yep. Yeah. 6 o'clock, Ben McNally.
And it's a good time. So people that
it's
are downtown.
It's a great time, and lots of special guests are also poets.
That'll
be a good night, I think.
So be a good night. So the cover is a photograph, I believe.
Yes.
And were you part of choosing the cover?
I was. The design is obviously beautiful. I'm very pleased with the design.
Yes.
The cover it shows two houses two sort of blocks of houses, like almost like tenement blocks that reflect each other with the sky between them.
Right.
And one of them looks very lived in, very spruced up, and the other one looks like no one has lived there for many, many years, and like it's about to fall down. And that image was kind of important to me because I feel like that other houses could mean many things, and I wanted the kind of the lived-in house and the abandoned house.
Yeah, it's a striking cover. And I'll just read a bit from the blurb on the back. In Other Houses, Kate Cayley's second collection of poetry, objects are alive with the presence of the people who have handled them. Myths and legends are interwoven with daily life. Visionaries, mystics, charlatans, artists, and the dead speak to us like chatty neighbors. An imaginary literary library catalogs missing people. Reading becomes a way of remembering the dead. Home is an elsewhere. We are called to a mystery that impels children to wander off and adults to grow in unexpected directions. So it really covers quite the gambit in your book. But the first, I guess there's three main sections. There is the first section, which is Writer's Bedrooms, which mm-hmm. I thought was a curious title. And then Other Houses, which is the title of the book. And then Library of the Missing, which I thought was quite interesting.
Well, I mean, those three sections, Writer's Bedrooms is a bit of a cheat. Writer's Bedrooms, there was originally a poem series that opened the collection that is called Writer's Bedrooms and is based on a series of photographs somebody did of the bedrooms of famous writers, but I mean, like the unoccupied bedrooms.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, it's really interesting. It really sparked for me. But the series in the end started to feel, it's hard when you're writing poems that are often kind of grounded in history to, you can kind of reduce them to biographical detail in a way that gets repetitive. And my editor and I decided to remove that. But then we thought, let's keep it as Writer's Bedrooms. That's really evocative. Like, who's in the bedroom? What does it mean? Which writer? So we kept that, and then Other Houses is obviously the title, but also recurs and comes up in one of the poems. And then for me, the idea of an other house is kind of the life that you imagine that you're not living. Also, another person is sort of an other house to you, that we're other houses to each other in a way. And then the last, The Library of the Missing, is after a poem series called The Library of the Missing that is set in an imaginary library in which all missing people are cataloged. But I also liked the idea of The Library of the Missing because that's kind of what a book is as well. Like you're trying to catalog, or especially poetry, like, or at least for me, you're trying to catalog or remember or somehow like snatch at the past that you don't totally apprehend, but that you are partly remembering and partly imagining, because memory is very tricky, which is another obsession of mine. So that's where the different titles came from.
Yeah, it's true. Memory is very does trick you.
It's very, very unstable. there was a very early version of the manuscript where I was trying to write poems about Elizabeth Loftus, who was she did the shopping mall experiment in, I think, in the 80s, where she tried to prove that memory can be created. So it is possible to remember a thing that you have not experienced if enough people around you tell you that that is what you remember. And this fascinated me. But again, it never really worked as a poem. It was just heavy-handed. Because then you think, oh, that's just, you know, the metaphor is right there staring you in the face. Like, you can't come at something sideways. So they were terrible poems. But so, it's definitely, I like to think she like permeates the book in other ways.
Well, there you go, that the influence is still there, but yeah, it might not be a direct influence. Which, do you write first and then have that conversation about whether the poem is something you want to keep working on, or do you?
I usually write and then leave things alone for a long time, because I also write fiction and plays. Mm-hmm. I'm often moving between things. I mean, as a way to like cobble together a living, and also I have attention span issues. So I will often leave things for a long time, sometimes really quite a long time. And so the question of what, but in this case, and in the case of my first book, the original manuscripts were like, I think, twice as long as what ended up finally there. Because you kind of, the more you, the deeper you get into the rewriting process, the more you see what was only superficially interesting, or what like maybe even is good but doesn't actually fit. It's hard when you have to start thinking of something as a collection. It's not just an individual poem anymore, right? But people will want, I would love for a reader to come through a thing and not feel that there's repetition, but do feel at the end that the whole thing fits. You know, okay, I can see how that was a collection. I can see how one thing led to the other. Doesn't jar.
And that it works together.
Yeah, hopefully. I mean, hopefully. Not perfectly, obviously. But, yeah.
Would you like to read from your book?
Sure. I'll read a poem.
Okay.
Let's start. I'm going to start with, this is from a series called A Partial List of People Who Have Claimed to Be Christ.
Yes, which, I wanted to ask you about that.
It's a very interesting section on Wikipedia when I was procrastinating one day, and then it turned into a poem series. Because it's a list of people who have claimed to be Christ through the ages, and this really fascinated me, because who were they?
Well,
you can a little. It's kind of funny, or at least the grandiosity of it. And when you look at it as a timeline, you see really interesting patterns. Like it's there's a lot of them in the U.S. in the 1880s, and again in North America generally in the 1960s. And you think, okay, well, that kind of makes sense. Like, yeah, you can see that there was something else at work. Anyway, so this one is actually in the voice of Anne Lee, and her dates are 1736 to 1784, and she was the founder of the Shakers. And so this is in her voice. She claimed that in her youth she'd been examined by ministers from the Church of England before she went to America, and this is about that. I will not sit in your presence, persecutors. Bareheaded before you I stand examined, men of English church, men of holy cloth, but I was a seamstress, snipping lives in my fingers. I could rip a seam like the ocean which I aimed to cross, leading my women and men who sweat alike and walk together, for only by the sameness of men and women shall either be redeemed. When I shudder, you will say the fit is on me and mock me, but I say you are filth to see filth. I shape with the word, myself, mother, and female form of Christ. My baby's dead, my womb blasted. God knew I was for other offers. Not for me the spindle, the bed. Shake your heads, churchmen. I see you titter as the rabble does. Do not touch me. I will burn your hands with holiness. Ask me any point of theology, and I will answer you in tongues. Cut mine out, I will speak. I will inherit. I will turn the world upside down.
Thank you. You're listening to Kate Cayley read from her book, Other Houses, which is published by Brick Books. That's a very powerful poem.
Thank you.
I guess when you brought up the grandiosity of it, I think that's what I find a bit humorous.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that, like, I can't imagine saying that myself.
No, but neither can I. But I also can't even imagine. It really interested me that certain historical periods are more fertile for that claim than other ones. Like, what's going on in a time that makes it, when you look at the timeline and you go, okay, why were there so many more people in this time and this place rather than this time and this place? Like, there must be something else going on. And if you think of, like, the Shakers and kind of radical, like, really, really radical Protestant movement and how that informed America, then that gets really interesting. I mean, that almost goes beyond the poem. But, yeah, the grandiosity of it is amazing. It's also, there's something totally horrifying and also kind of admirable in this, like, wow, these people were really opening, like, ripping open the world in a way that is, and some of them had a huge impact, like Ann Lee, like the Shakers were actually quite influential at their height, and then the other figures I looked at are just, like, probably now would have just been called paranoid schizophrenics and had kind of other avenues for treatment, but, you know, kind of wandered from town to town prophesying the end of the world or whatever it was. And that, it was just quite an image. It was really strong for me.
Oh. So you get your ideas from everywhere, I guess, if you look on Wikipedia and the internet.
That was just good luck.
Well, there you go. There you go. You get rewarded, I think, if you're in the right frame of mind. If you're open to ideas. I really like the poem about a poem I read once.
Oh, nice. Nobody's ever noted that one. That's funny. Maybe if I read another one, I'll read that.
Okay. And,
I have never, that actually, if anyone, maybe I'll read it and maybe a listener will remember which poem I mean.
Okay.
And it was, I was in a community center. Someone had left an old copy of, I think, the London Review of Books. I read a poem. It was beautiful and horrifying, and I have no clue who it was by. And I've always hoped to find it again, so I decided to write a poem about my impression of that poem.
This is,
and I'm like, I want this back, but I never did.
You never know. You never know.
You never know. You never know.
This is about a poem I read once.
All right, shall I read it?
Yes, please.
Okay, about a poem I read once. A brooch, a mirror. A girl comes seeking into an empty house. Walls crumble at her foggy breath. It has been winter a long time, more than any orderly season. The house in the middle of a wood, branches lattice the spare light. Homeless in her icy house, she unmuffles in front of the mirror, a brooch at her throat. In the mirror, the brooch becomes an eye. The eye opens. She sees what it is. I don't recall whether the house remained empty, whether another face rose up behind her, wolf or sorcerer or perilous mother only recently dead, whether she was blessed with a sign and went on, or stayed. The eye becomes a mouth and speaks. Outside, it begins to snow.
Thank you.
Thank you. That's funny. As I read that, I realize it's also just very tied into the kind of fairy tale motif, which I think the original poem was as well.
It's tied into, sorry, I missed.
Fairy tales. Like fairy tales and the way that fairy tales are like, especially when I was younger, I was really fascinated by how fairy tales are really tied to body horror. Like there were a lot of feminist rewrites of fairy tales in the 80s and 90s, like I'm thinking mostly of Angela Carter, that got really into kind of the body being cut open or reconfigured or magically transformed in some way. And I just remember this original poem. So yeah, if anyone listens and remembers that poem, please let me know.
Yeah, that would be
I'd love
great.
To read it again. It was really good.
Unfortunately, I don't, but but yeah, I like the fluidity of it, and the brooch was this sort of, it changed, and I like things that transfer and move around, and it had a magic to it, I thought.
Thank you. I mean, that's funny, because of course, when you say things that transfer and move around,
yes,
I think, oh, but that's what a poem does. Like, that you are kind of, even like, that you are creating these connections or bridges that aren't always apparent, and yet once you make them, you go, oh, okay, that's what that was.
I think that's true when a poem, when they work, I think, for me, or if they really stand out, there's something alive about them, I think, lack of a better word, but that they have a
No, I think alive is a really good word.
Oh, okay. Because that's what I think a good good poem, or one that speaks to me. I shouldn't say, I mean, a lot of poems are good, but the ones that speak to me, I think that's what, they just do that for me. I was interested in the section on Library of the Missing. And did this take a lot of research to do?
No, they're entirely fictional.
They're all fictional.
Yeah, completely.
Oh, okay.
Made up sources are something I really love. Like, if somebody, I love also fiction and short stories that like will present something as if it's an absolute history, and you go, wait a minute, is that real?
Yes.
You know, Stephen Price in his I think it's called Sacred Omens in the Year of the Ox. His poetry collection from whenever it was. It was a few years ago now, but it was so good. Brick published it too, actually. But I remember there was a part in it where he writes with absolute authority about something that had happened in a German village. And it, right after the Second World War, I don't even want to give it away, but it's a horrifying poem. And I thought, oh my goodness, I had never heard of this. Looked it up, couldn't find it anywhere. And I thought, you made that up. But you presented it in such a way that you read it and think, oh, of course, he's riffing on something that's in the historical record. And maybe it is. Like, I could be wrong. It could be, like, something cannot be on the internet and still exist. But that was interesting. So, yeah, everything in the Library of the Missing is completely fictional.
Because it's set up that each item that you talk about has an item number.
Yeah.
And you have four categories of the types of missing, I guess.
I mean, this is actually linked. Those poems are actually linked to a theater project. They sort of grew, not out of it, but together with it, that I worked on with a company out in Halifax called the Archive of. It was called the Archive of Missing Things. It was things rather than people.
Okay.
That seems sort of more fruitful and less invasive of the idea of a missing person.
For performance, I can see that.
For performance, and that project, we did create a fictional online archive. It would be hard to describe, but there was this online component where the audience was also kind of going through the fictional archive as they were watching the performance. And for those things, everything did have an item number, and it was part of something very vast that took a long time to create.
I was going to say, how long did that take?
You don't even want to know.
Oh,
a really long
goodness.
Time.
Ambitious.
A long, long time.
Very ambitious.
It was a good project. It was a good project.
Good.
But these poems sort of grew out of that. And yeah, they are fiction.
They are fiction.
Yeah.
I guess we might have time for one more poem.
Right.
If you'd like to pick or...
Sure. I mean, would you like... If we've just been talking about that section, so maybe I'll read the last one in that series.
Okay.
So these are... these poems, just to ground it, are about a fictional... This is the fictional library of missing people. And the final poem, it requires a less explanation, is called On the Nature of Disappearance. When alone, I imagined myself as a person made of glass, so all my blood pumping could be seen. At what point after a person vanishes does their absence become inevitable? So that in considering the moment when they disappeared, it becomes impossible to imagine anything other than their disappearance. Conversely, does this ever happen? Or is a moment of disappearance, in fact, a split in time, in which two things happen at once? One thing, I have disappeared into nothing. Or, I have entered into everything. The rustle of rats in the wall, the drip of the tap, a bad taste in the mouth, an abrupt, alarming smell. Walking alone, you come upon a single glove or shoe pressed into the light snow, or find a handprint on the wrong side of a window pane, or find a collection of marbles still grouped carefully together in the backyard. Messages.
Thank you. You're listening to Kate Cayley read from her book Other Houses, and this is published by Brick Books, and Kate will be at the Ben McNally Bookstore on Thursday. This coming Thursday at 6 o'clock, is that right?
Yep, that's right. The readings will start at 6:30.
At 6:30, so it gives time for people to get organized and
exactly
and get ready, and there'll be other readers there as well.
It's a great, great lineup of other Brick poets who'll be reading with me, and I think there will also be wine and cheese.
Oh, and wine and cheese bonus.
There you go.
So, and do you have a website?
I do. It's www.katecayley.ca.
Okay. So yeah, that should be easy
to find.
For people to find. And and it's been a real pleasure talking to you, Kate.
Well, it's been great talking to you.
And I enjoyed your book. So have a great reading and good luck with it.
Thank you. All right. Take care.
You too. Thank you.
Okay. Bye.
Cheers. Bye. This is CIUT 89.5 FM. We were just speaking with Kate Cayley with her book Other Houses, which she's launching at Ben McNally Bookstore Thursday night. Arrive at 6, and it starts at 6:30, so it should be a great night with lots of readers there. We're going to take a short break for some PSAs, and this is a reminder that next week I'll be sharing sharing the show with Valentino Essenza. It's our fall fundraiser, so I hope you can listen and participate and be part of that. There's lots of prizes and stuff in the draws, so we'll be talking more about that next week. You can always go to CIUT.fm and find out more about the fundraiser and how to donate there as well. So that would be great. Thank you so much for your support of HOWL and CIUT. We're going to take a short break. We're going to be back with Aaron Tucker and talk about his book, which is very fascinating. This is called Irresponsible Mediums, The Chess Games of Marcel Duchamp. And we're going to listen first to a track from Big Sugar from their album called Yard Style. And then we'll be back with Aaron. Cheers.
CIUT 89.5 FM, bringing you the sound of your city for 30 years. Still bright.
It has that to it. This is CIUT 89.5 FM. Nancy Jane Bullis Greer in the chair tonight, and I'm very pleased to have in the studio, Aaron Tucker is here to talk about his book, Irresponsible Mediums, The Chess Games of Marcel Duchamp. And thank you so much for being here.
Oh, thank you.
It's just to introduce you, you're in here too? Where are you? Maybe I didn't get that part. Just like to introduce Aaron to you. Aaron Tucker is the author of 4 books, Irresponsible Mediums, The Chess Games of Marcel Duchamp, and the poetry collection Punchlines, which was published by Mansfield Press, as well as 2 scholarly texts, Virtual Weaponry, The Militarized Internet in Popular Cinema, and Interfacing with the Internet in Popular Cinema, both with Palgrave Macmillan. His current collaborative project, Lost Sets, translates poems into sculptures, which are then 3D printed. Wow. He is also the co-creator of the Chess Bard, an app that transforms chess games into poems. And I think we're going to be talking more about that. In addition, he is a professor in the English department at Ryerson University, and he's got a website, which I'm sure we'll talk about a bit too. Thank you.
That's great. Thank you.
So yeah, it's great to have you in the studio. And when I first read the title, Chess and Marcel Duchamp. I didn't put that together at all. I thought, isn't he like I don't know what kind, an artist like Pablo Picasso and Matisse, sort of in that cubism.
Well, he has a long, long history of playing chess, but also incorporating chess into his early work. He had a number of paintings kind of early on in the 1910s as he was starting to learn how to paint, and then he really incorporated playing chess into his practice kind of in the 1920s and on. He's a very, very good correspondence chess player. He was one of the 5 best chess players in France at one point. He was on the chess Olympiad team. He was really, really good.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
it was a new window for me
into
Marcel Duchamp, for sure. And I was reading, it was interesting, he says that all chess players are artists, but not all artists are chess players.
Mm-hmm.
So he really saw chess as an art form.
Absolutely, and I think he saw the game as a way of kind of playing with human rationality, but also kind of these infinite numbers of infinite moves and infinite games and how it kind of expanded out from there. So he talked a lot about chance and luck as a way of kind of, and game playing. Like he was a rascal. That's mostly what I like about him as well. He liked to play things. He liked to make fun of things. He loved puns. He loved games, word games, and actual games. He was at one point he was selling stakes in a roulette system he had developed. So he'd go and take people's money and go to Monte Carlo. So there's, if you Google images, you can actually see the like very specific bonds he made that he would give people that are now very valuable just as art objects.
As art objects, wow. Wow. And I guess it was, and I guess the Jennifer
Shahade. Yeah.
She talks about this a bit in the book as well, is that the development of chess, I guess, with artificial intelligence, it was one of the things where they could see if a like IBM, like Watson, could play chess and beat humans. And then now it's been sort of found out that they can.
Right.
And now you're flipping it the other way, where you're taking the chess and with ChessBard, I guess, you have this app.
Yeah.
That you've got these different, I guess, chess games that Marcel played.
Yeah.
And who his opponents are and whether he's white or whether he's black.
Yeah.
On the board and then let the computer.
Yeah, so it was initially inspired by a piece that he and American composer John Cage did.
Oh, I like John Cage.
Yeah, he's amazing.
Yeah.
In here in Toronto, actually, at Ryerson University, at my home university, where they built a chessboard that when you moved a piece to a square, it made a sound. And so the idea was the game would be translated into a score. And so I kind of liked that idea.
Wow.
And it seemed really cool. He... in the piece, no record of the game still survives, but he played without his knight, and he beat John Cage in about 25 minutes. He was just a really good chess player. And then the second game, Cage played Teenie, his wife, and that game went for about 3 hours, and Marcel got tired, so they stopped. Yeah. So I was really inspired by this, and so Jody Miller and I sent an email on Craigslist, and he answered, and he was really fantastic. Like, all good things start on Craigslist. And we built this app, and the basic principle of it is I wrote 12 poems, 6 for the white pieces, 6 for the black pieces. Each poem is 64 words, so each square gets a word, and then when a piece moves to a square, it triggers a word, and then there's some language templates and computer stuff that's going on that kind of makes it a little bit less word soupy and more grammatical.
More word soupy, I like that.
Yeah.
Or it's just like a bunch of like a Scrabble board kind of.
Yeah, the first iteration of it before we started kind of doing some of the language template stuff was nonsense, kind of delightful nonsense, but nonsense nonetheless. So
you wanted to make some more sense out of it.
Yeah, exactly. And so we've built... on the website, chesspoetry.com, you can upload old games, so any game, and you can have both sides translated, or there's also a AI, so you can play against a chess AI and in real time translate it into poems.
So what's your website? Where can people find out more about this?
So for this one, it's chesspoetry.com, and then my personal website's just my name, aarontucker.ca.
.ca. Mm-hmm. And then, so... And there's three sections. There's the opening games, the middle games, and then the end game.
Yeah, absolutely.
And that sort of, I guess, goes through his time with the chess games that he played.
Yeah, I tried to get all of the chess games. I imagine I missed some of them, but there's about 80 or so that are recorded, and so we put them through the translator, and some of them turned out really beautifully, I think.
Yeah. And so they're not all in here. You did an editing of...
No, we just couldn't find some of them. Like, again, Reunion wasn't taken down. There's another game I know that only exists in a very specific book. And, so we were a little bit limited by the online databases. Yeah.
But it's still enough to really put together.
Absolutely, yeah.
Would you like to read from your book for us?
Sure, absolutely. I can read a few. I can read one of my favorite ones, which is his game against Vera Menchik. She was the first world women's chess champion.
He encouraged women, too.
Yeah, he did. There's a very famous sort of photo of him playing Eve Babbitts, where Eve Babbitts is completely naked, and he's across the chessboard entirely ignoring her, super focused on the chessboard. but he played against Vera Menchik, who again was the first world women's chess champion. Jen writes about her in the introduction as well. Jen's really mm-hmm. lovely introduction. So this is him playing the white pieces in Paris in 1929. A sandy resistance or lock, not any red or plaster lively applauds cube lock. Each consideration burns that spoon, abjectly observes and sounds desert bound shift and interest, reproduced grinder, single stage above, circled chorus, and reform.
That's playing white versus Vera Menchik, Paris 1929. And grinder is that the name of a poker player?
It is, yeah. That also Jen mentions that in her introduction as well. It also is one of Duchamp's more famous pieces, The Chocolate Grinder.
Okay.
Yeah, from the mid-1910s, somewhere 1916, I want to say, something like that.
So did he, when he just decided to stop art as
he didn't
an
stop.
Active artist?
Yeah, well, he didn't ever stop.
Stop.
But he definitely maybe made a little bit less, but he never gave it up. I mean, Attente Donnée, which is his last piece, was his last piece. He was still making that when he died.
So, because he was it the mid-60s mm-hmm. he died?
Late 60s.
Late 60s. So he went through that whole period with Pablo Picasso and sort of that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think
I guess it is abstract, but not.
Some of it would have been. Yeah.
Yeah.
Some of his early pieces, like Nude Descending a Staircase, were definitely
that's
influenced.
Abstract.
Yeah. Like cubist-y sort of things, yeah.
Have you run this by other chess players?
Yeah, well, Jen is a two-time U.S. women's
chess champion.
Yeah, and so she really, I reached out to her kind of without knowing her, and she very generously decided to write the introduction, which was really nice, and she really likes it. And her and I have done a number of performances using this. Usually the last two that we've done, she's played blindfolded, and I play with my eyes wide open, and she destroys me. And then as we play, the game is translated into poems, and then at the end we read the poem that came out of this game.
Awesome.
Yeah. So there's pictures and things like that on the website as well.
Yeah. And she has some pictures that you were talking about, that one where Duchamp was playing Eve Babbitts.
Yeah.
And that she was nude, and Jen did a flip on that. There's a picture of it where there's a man, a naked man, and she's fully. So they did a switch on that.
Yeah. Yeah, and the book is really beautiful. I think it's got her lovely introduction has a number of illustrations. So Derek Bollea has some beautiful visual pieces that are kind of augmenting it. There's also some really interesting, like I've tried to include some of the chess notation, which I also find interesting.
Mm-hmm.
It's a real mix of different types of languages and imagery and ways of thinking about chess and poetry, I think, too.
And poetry, too, and language, which I think fits in, like we were talking before, with what Jay and Hazel Miller are interested in with their press,
mm-hmm.
is to explore language and to look at it from a, I guess from a, well, it's a combination of you've got the computer, but you also have the game itself. So there's another element.
Absolutely. And I've been sort of talking about this book as co-authored, that I am co-authoring this book, because the computer is doing it's not just compiling. There is some choice of templates and things like that that go on that are doing some of the grammatical things in here. I can go backwards. I can look at a poem and see, like, okay, this is how this poem was made. But when I translate these poems using the computer, I have no clue what's going to come out.
Neat.
Yeah.
Yeah. Sort of like hit the button and poof.
Yeah. There's a little button that says Poetify, and then it makes a poem.
Oh,
yeah.
It really is. It's called Poetify?
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, that's awesome. That's awesome. Yeah, these, there are illustrations in here from Derek
Bullio, yeah.
Bullio.
Yeah.
And And did he see the text before he did his images, or?
I think he had seen some of the text. I sent him some specific chess positions. So these are the last moves of the game.
Okay, and then that's he translated, what I was wondering. Yeah,
he translated the last moves into these sorts of images.
Into the images.
Yeah.
Would you like to read another poem?
Sure. Maybe I'll read the last one in the book just because I like it. Partly because it is a correspondence poem that he played against Grime, Luring, Ree, and Crab. So this is in 1961. He's playing black. Blazing estimate or diagonal half, mimes and inquires chord texture. Memorize screen in the database, texture places underneath thought, or each butt times screen the habitual isolation forms or strands beyond.
Thank you. You're listening to Aaron Tucker read from his book, which he has said that he has co-authored with the computer. and it is called Irresponsible Mediums, The Chess Games of Marcel Duchamp. And the cover is, how did the cover come about?
So that was at Book Thug. They have obviously a bunch of really great design work in
they
particular.
Do.
Yeah, it was Malcolm Sutton. Came up with this particular version of this, and I think it is. It's really beautiful. It mixes in like a lot of kind of soft colors with the text over top, kind of mimicking a chessboard, and the arrows, in fact, on the chessboard. That's very similar to the types of arrows that show up in chess diagrams. If you look at chess books, yeah.
Oh, okay. I have one. I was going to look at it. I thought maybe I better bone up on chess. I haven't played in years.
The great thing about this is you don't really need to know how to play chess to make a poem out of the chess games. I go into classrooms, and what I found is that players that are equal tend to produce better poems, because otherwise you end up getting little short poems if one player kind of destroys the other one.
Yeah. So the
better, yeah, exactly. So the better versions tend to be when players can play a little bit long of a game. Yeah.
Wow. How the longest you said that Marcel Duchamp played, like 3 hours sounds like a long time for me for a chess game.
Yeah.
Is that a long time?
Not for professional chess players. No. Not at all. No, like when they play the world.
Yeah, and you see them with the clock and
they
get their time and
yeah, and I think that's part of what drew me to chess just as a game separate from this project is I'm fascinated by people who can do it really well because it seems like something that my human brain is so completely incapable of. And even Jen, who did the introduction, I think she's such an interesting person. Like, not only can she literally beat me blindfolded to the point where she was trying to checkmate me with a pawn, like, she was just playing games with me. She also is a professional poker player and like all sorts of other things.
So she's a gamer. She
yeah,
really likes
exactly.
Like
yeah.
And her brain probably is wired that way that
mm-hmm, to understand can, patterns and yeah. to like do really far-reaching pattern recognition. And Garry Kasparov, I think they said like he could imagine a position 25 moves ahead.
Like
just the sort of way that chess forces you to think, I think, is really interesting.
that every right up to the opening move matters.
Absolutely, yeah. And part of what I also like about this is this project, you can't have a white poem without a black poem, that they're each interdependent, that each word kind of depends on the other word. And as you play chess and you make a move, the other person moves in response. And so the poems end up being a really interesting conversation between the two, between the white and the black pieces. And I think it's even more interesting when you involve like a machine player and a human player and how do their poems talk to each other.
So ChessBard, that's the app?
Yes. Yeah, that's the app that Jody and I made together.
That you guys made together.
Yeah.
And is it just for you, or can other people use
no.
it?
No, so it's on chesspoetry.com. You can upload old chess games, or you can play. There's a play against a chess AI there. So you can go there and play, and as you play, it translates in real time.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, so we've done some interesting things with it. On November 21st, we're doing a kind of a performance to launch this book. It's at the Arts and Letters Club at 7 o'clock. And Jen and I are going to do a performance. I think what we're going to do is she's going to play three games simultaneously, and we'll translate those in real time. And then there'll be some other readers as well, Stuart Ross and Beatrice Howler.
Oh, nice, yeah. So they can get a good sort of variety of and performance chess.
Yeah.
Performance chess poetry.
Yes. Well, so. Jen is a very good performer as well. She's done hula chess. She's done really interesting. One project she was involved in was a game where the chess pieces were candles. So you had to checkmate your opponent before the candle went out.
There seems like a lot of pressure.
Yeah. Chess in general is a lot of pressure. I don't think I could play in front of people for a living. It seems too much. Like, even the few times her and I have performed together, it's been uniquely stressful.
Yeah. But, you know, I think it's something for people to see.
Yeah.
To actually get a sense. So where is that again? The Books and Letters Club?
Arts and Letters Club.
Arts and Letters.
It's right near Ryerson Campus, I believe. Elm and Young Street.
Yeah, that's what I remember. It's still on Elm Street.
Yeah, and fully accessible and everything, yeah.
Oh, that's good. And it's on November...
21st. 21st at 7 o'clock.
Okay, and that's... Well, that would be a Tuesday night.
A Tuesday night, yes.
I was thinking it's... Because I know 7:14. Tuesday nights, I know my date, so
yes.
It's a Tuesday night.
Mm-hmm.
That's actually two weeks from now.
2 weeks from now, yeah.
So people have time to mark it in their calendar.
Exactly.
And it's a fascinating concept and it's interesting. And I think everybody has at least some familiarity with chess.
Mm-hmm.
That, I mean, I'm certainly not even close.
No.
I haven't played in years. But I know what a rook is and a queen and the pawns and how it goes, yeah.
Yeah, and I think that's part of one of the gateways into this book, that chess is played all over the world in all sorts of different forms, and I think it's a really effective way to think about game playing and language.
Yeah, it's a fascinating read. So I wish you all the best with this.
Oh, thank you so much.
And thank you so much for coming in and talking to us about your book.
Oh, no problem at all. Thank you.
You're very welcome. This is CIUT 89.5 FM, and we've been speaking with Aaron Tucker with his book. It's like a concept book, I think.
Yeah.
Irresponsible Mediums, The Chess Games of Marcel Duchamp. And it's also, I think, the book is a work of art. There's a lot of visual art in it. And so it's definitely worth checking out. And he'll be at the Arts and Letters on November 21st, which is 2 weeks from today. And it starts at...
7 o'clock.
At 7 o'clock.
Mm-hmm.
And Jennifer Shahade will be there with Aaron, and they'll be performing chess. Awesome.
Yes.
Well, thanks so much.
Oh, no problem. Thank you.
Take care.
Thanks.
This is CIUT 89.5 FM, and we've been speaking with Aaron Tucker about his book, Irresponsible Mediums, The Chess Games of Marcel Duchamp, and he'll be at the Arts and Letters Club on November 21st. In the first half of the show, we talked to Kate Cayley with her book, Other Houses, published by Brick Books, and she'll be launching her book this Thursday at Ben McNally Bookstore, and the doors open at 6. Well, I'm sure they're open before. It's a bookstore. The gathering begins at 6, and the readings will be at 6:30. So please check that out. And thanks so much for listening. And Valentino Ascens and I will be here together next week for the show. It's our fall fundraiser. So please tune that dial to 89.5 FM and enjoy, listen to the show. And we're going to close out with a track from, this was a collaboration between Albert King and Stevie Ray Vaughan. This is called Blues at Sunrise on CIUT 89.5 FM. Thanks for listening. And please remember, lights on bikes. Cheers.
CIUT 89.5 FM, bringing you the sound of your city for 30 years.